Man, everybody ought to. Say it again, we ought to. Praise the Lord. Amen. Welcome to the house of the Lord tonight, to our Wednesday night Bible study. And I'm going to open up a little something tonight called the pastor's business card. It said a new pastor was visiting in the homes of some of his members. In one house, it seemed obvious that somebody was at home, but no answer came to his repeated knocks at the door. So he took out one of his business cards, and on the back he wrote Revelation chapter 3, verse number 20. Wrote that on the back of the card and stuck it in the door. So when the offering was processed the following Sunday, he found out that his card had been returned to him. And added to it on the back was this scripture, Genesis chapter 3, verse number 10. So reaching for his Bible to check out exactly what they were saying, and when he found it, he broke out in gales of laughter. Revelation chapter 3, verse number 20, what the pastor had written on the card to begin with says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in with him and sup with him, and he with me." Then Genesis 3:10, which they had written back, said, "I heard your voice in the garden, but I was afraid, for I was naked." Couple of announcements. This Saturday will be our Easter egg hunt for all children ages 12 and under. So if we've got any kids, any children in your family or neighbors, you know, that you want to invite or friends, be sure to let them know this Saturday, 12 and under, we're going to meet in the sanctuary first at 11 a.m. And our children's pastors, Adam and Amy, are going to do a illustrated presentation to the kids for Easter. And then they're going to go outside and enjoy the Easter egg hunt. And they're going to have a big obstacle course Spider-Man thing they can run through. And the Easter bunny is going to be out there. So it'll be a wonderful day. They have, I think, enough help running the Easter egg hunt. Correct, Sister Amy? But they could use a little help from some men to help Pastor Timmy set up the big obstacle course Friday afternoon, 4 o'clock. So some folks have already said they would come and help stuff Easter eggs at 4. We appreciate that Friday. Also, any guys they could use maybe a little help with a few men that would help Pastor Timmy set up that big Spider-Man obstacle course and have that ready for the kids, that would be much appreciated. Then Saturday again, 11 a.m., all that will begin here at the church campus. Sunday, I will conclude the series we've been in for several weeks entitled The God of the Turnaround. At the conclusion of that service, we are also going to receive Believer's Communion. That's always a wonderful time that we can celebrate together and remember the sacrifice that Jesus has made, and especially this time of year because that will be Palm Sunday. So obviously all of those things are on our minds and our hearts as we think about the cross that Jesus bore, and then, of course, his resurrection. So Sunday, we'll finish the series. We'll take communion, and then immediately following the service, our young people, the Flawless Youth Ministry, are going to be set up under the portico. So as you exit, they'll be right out there doing a hot dog fundraiser to-go meals, and that is for their Winterfest trip. They had to make a few changes. Winterfest usually has already happened. It's like the first or second weekend of March. Because of COVID, it got pushed to the 1st of May, so that way they can actually be outdoors. So they're not going to be inside. They're going to be outdoors at a big arena and socially distant and all those things. So it's going to look a little different, but at least they still get to go. So the kids are excited about that, and we want to help them, help fund them so they can get there. So anything you purchase Sunday will go to our young people after the service. Next Wednesday, we will not be having our normal Bible study, but we have opted to show the 2019 production of The Glory of His Resurrection. And that is such a wonderful outreach ministry tool that, again, we have just been so heartbroken that we've been unable to present that drama the past 2 years, this being the second year. So we thought this would be at least an opportunity that we can enjoy that in some measure, and we can come together, especially for those who have been in that for so many years and been a part. But everyone is welcome. Next Wednesday, 7 p.m., we will be showing that Easter drama from 2019 on the big screen behind me. And then the Sunday after that, believe it or not, will be Easter Sunday. And we're celebrating our risen Lord. Can the church say amen? And I'll be preaching a message the Lord's laid on my heart entitled, Let God Arise. Would you stand to your feet tonight? We just want to open up in prayer and ask the Lord to bless our service tonight and to touch you. There are several requests here that I will go over if we continue to pray for Mary Kate. I'm going to continue to pray for her complete healing. Bobby Gravely is recuperating from that shoulder replacement surgery that he had on Monday. So if you'd please continue to pray for Bobby. Juanita Questenberry, who's battling cancer tonight and needs a healing, if you remember her. Billy Linkus is still recuperating from the eye surgery that he had last week. Rebecca Burnett, if you'd please pray for her, the little baby. She's 38 weeks pregnant, and the little girl has turned in the womb, so she is breached right now. And if she does not turn back the other way, they're going to have to do a C-section potentially next week. So please pray for Rebecca and for the baby. If you'd pray for Vincent Surface, this is Daryl's brother who has been in the hospital. Cindy Anderson, Patsy's daughter, if you remember her in prayer, she has also been in the hospital overnight last night. I just talked to her before I come out here, and she is home now. But they had thought that she was having a heart attack, but ended up it was not a heart attack. But she does have a small blockage, but it is one that they believe they can treat with medication. So we're thankful for that. But if you continue to pray for Cindy as she recuperates now. Also, Elizabeth Sifford's mom, she needs our prayers tonight. And then if you'd pray for the Reed family, this is Kay Robinson's uncle who passed away. Pray for the Blair family. This is our international youth director that you may have heard Pastor Joni request prayer for on Sunday, who is battling complications, severe complications with COVID, and he passed away. So we want to pray for that family. Also for the Cromer family. I'll be preaching that funeral tomorrow. It's a lady that had come to our church just a little bit, but a good friend of Mary Kate's. If you'd pray for that family, she went home to be with the Lord on Saturday. And then also the Albert family, which is one of our neighbors. She had cancer and passed away. So if you please pray for that family as well. If you have a special need in your life, in your heart, somebody you know of that just needs a touch tonight, would you just lift your hand to the Lord all over this sanctuary? Amen. God sees those hands and He knows what we have need of tonight. Look, could we all just join together and pray? Father, we come to you tonight in the beautiful and the holy and the matchless name of Jesus. And Lord, we pray, God, for these requests. Lord, I pray, Father, for every need that I have mentioned out loud in prayer here tonight. I pray, Lord, for every hand that was raised, Lord, in this sanctuary, God, that represent needs in people's lives, Lord, tonight. God, maybe there's some that are watching by Facebook Live, Lord, that have a need. I pray that you would touch them, Lord, in a special way. God, that you would do what the Bible says that you will do, that you'll meet all of our needs according to your riches and glory. I pray, God, for those that need healing in their body tonight, Lord, that you would just minister health, God, and strength. Lord, as we think about the cross of Calvary, as we think about, Lord, this time of year, and we reflect, Lord, on the stripes that God, you took upon your back. They were laid there, the Bible says, for our healing, that with your stripes we are healed. So, Lord, we declare that, we decree that, we stand on that by faith tonight, Lord, that, Father, you would heal, God, you would touch every one of these names, God, that is on this piece of paper here tonight, on this pulpit, every hand that was raised, God, that maybe represents a physical need in somebody's life, you would touch them and heal them, God, and strengthen them tonight. Lord, I pray for all these families, Lord, that I have mentioned, the Reed family and Blair family and Cromer family and Albert family, Lord, and I'm sure there are many more, God, that have lost loved ones, God, over these past few days or past couple of weeks, God. We just pray that you would comfort them and strengthen them, Father, I pray, in the name of Jesus. God, you said you're the God of all comfort, and you comfort us in all of our troubles so that we can then comfort others with the same comfort that we ourselves have received from you, Lord. The name we can call the Holy Spirit is the Comforter, God. And that's what I pray, Lord, tonight, that God, you would do what I preached on Sunday, Lord. You would comfort those that mourn, and you would provide, Lord, I pray, for those that grieve in Zion. Lord, we're so thankful, God, that you're an ever-present help, God, in the time of trouble, that, Lord, you're with us, that you'll never leave us, you'll never forsake us, God, but you'll walk with us, God, right up to the very end of the age, God. Encourage, Lord, I pray, this church, God. Encourage, Lord, I pray, their families, God. Encourage, Lord, all of the families and the marriages and the children and the brothers and sisters, Lord, that they represent, the parents that they represent. Encourage them, Lord, tonight to know that you are still on the throne, that you are still in control, and that, God, you are sovereign over all. Lord, I pray for this service tonight. You'll bless and anoint the rest of our worship. Would you bless and anoint Pastor Joni? I pray as she's going to come in just a moment and deliver unto us, God, what you've given to her. Lord, this teaching, as we continue to talk about what it means to have faith through the fire, help us, God, to stand strong. Help us, God, to endure to the end. Because those that endure, God, you said they shall be saved. We're so thankful, God, for your presence and your anointing. And we give you the praise and the glory and the honor for all that you've done, you're doing, and you continue to do. We give you thanks, and we pray all these things in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen and amen. You can be seated in the house of the Lord tonight. I'm going to ask Brother Jack if he would come at this time and prepare to wait on the congregation, just in case you were not here Sunday after the service when we had our business meeting. The church did vote to move forward with a brand new church sign, so we are thankful for that. I know Brother Jack's thankful for that, because he's been the one that's been having to pull his truck out there in snow and sleet and rain and ice and wind and whatever else come, trying to change the letters on the sign. Now we can do it all from a computer. It's digital, and it sends a signal out there to the sign. So hopefully in about 6 to 8 weeks, roughly, we should have a brand new LED digital sign. The whole sign's 15 foot tall, and the LED boards by themselves are 8 foot long and 4 feet tall. So there, it's going to be a pretty big sign, but it'll be impressive and be a great way to help us advertise what's going on the inside, so people on the outside can find out that there's good stuff happening on the inside. Can the church say amen? Tell you what, if we could broadcast some of these Holy Ghost services we've been having, boy, they'd be driving off the side of the road seeing what was going on out there. We probably shouldn't do that. But thank you so much for your giving. I said all that to say this. Thank you for your giving, because your giving, your faithfulness to the Lord is what makes all those things that we're able to do to continue to minister to the community. It makes it possible. So we appreciate your faithfulness to the Lord tonight. Brother Jack, would you say a blessing over this offering tonight? Amen. I'll invite the right side of the sanctuary. If you have offering tonight, you can stand and exit toward the wall and just circle right around and place your offering in there. And then also the left side can do the same thing. You guys can stand and exit toward the wall and circle right around and place your offering in and right up the center aisle. God bless you tonight. Thank you as you give to the Lord.
that song. And I remember that is one of the first songs I learned how to play on the guitar. And I loved it because I only knew three chords, but those were the three chords I knew. But how many knows that's what it's going to take nowadays, just a closer walk with Thee. And you know, I was thinking of something I heard a preacher say, between the difference between vicinity and proximity. Boy, I had those two wrong. I thought vicinity and proximity were the same things, but he set me straight. He said the vicinity of something is being close to it, but not exact. He's like, the man took me out to dig for a hole for a pipeline. He says it's somewhere in this vicinity. And he said, brother, that's just not going to do, because this pipeline's going to have 100 pounds of pressure on it. I don't want to be digging, hit that pipe, and it spray all over me. So he said, but proximity means you know exactly where it's at, and you can draw close to it. And he related it this way. Some of us are happy being in the vicinity of Jesus. And you can be. You can be extremely happy in the vicinity of Jesus, because that's just his power and his presence. But how many will agree you want to be in proximity to Jesus? See, I don't want to just know he may be over there, or he may be. I want to know that Jesus is in proximity with me. Because how many can agree that what God did for us is completely amazing? Now, here lately, I've been digging into those old hymns and reading what those psalmists wrote. You know, those guys didn't have a vicinity type relationship with God. When you can still write praises to God while your ship is sailing, where your children and your wife just went down. See, that's what that song, "It Is Well With My Soul." He was actually traveling over the waters where the ship went down. But what was he saying? It is well. It is well with my soul. And the only way, church, that we can be that way is if we are in relationship with Jesus. Not vicinity, but proximity to Jesus. Father God, I thank you, because there is no measure to the depth of your love for us. God, I just want to give you praise and glory for all you've done. Thank you. How deep the Father's love. step down from your throne in glory to come to earth. Sacrifice your flesh for us, just to draw us close to you. Lord, I pray right now, those who are under the sound of my voice and those who may be watching by film, Lord, I'm not just the sinner saved by grace, God, and not just the servant of the Most High.
Aren't you so thankful tonight that his wounds paid our ransom? That's why we can stand here tonight and feel the sweet presence of the Lord. Look at all that he has done for us. Lord, tonight we want to thank you and praise you for your presence that is here with us tonight. And we want to thank you for your love. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Thank you, Father, that because of your love and because of the sacrifice your Son made, we can have everlasting life in eternity with you. We want you to know, Father, that we love you. We thank you for your presence that is here with us. We ask, God, that you would continue to move throughout this service, Lord. Let us open our hearts tonight and receive your word. But God, don't let us just receive it, but let us apply it to our each and every day, and go forth, Lord, and be the men and women of God that you have called us to be. We want you to know that we love you, we praise you, and we give you glory, for it's in the name of Jesus that we pray. And everyone said, amen, amen. Thank you to our praise and worship team and our musicians, Pastor Mikey, those beautiful songs. It's just so wonderful to feel the presence of the Lord here tonight. We're going to be going into our second lesson of faith through the fire. And what we're going to be talking about tonight is facing weakness and frustration. Can any of you identify with that? I think we got some hands going up. I'll raise mine too. Many times in trials, weakness blurs our vision and my frustration gets so out of hand. And then I'm reminded, I've never been forsaken. I've never had to stand one test alone. First off, before we get started tonight, I want to ask you, have any of you sitting here ever experienced trials, frustration, disappointment, discouragement? You know what I'm talking about? Have you ever had times when you feel like your cup is overflowing with nothing but weakness? And it doesn't matter how good a day you had yesterday. How many of you know some days you can have a really good day and the next day can turn totally upside down? That happens. Can anyone say yes to that? Well, guess what? You're not alone. Welcome to the real world. This is the real world. This is things that we are going to face. There are challenges in life that we do have to face. And guess what? They have a mind of their own. Stop and listen for just a moment. First of all, they don't come knocking at your door asking permission to enter. Second, they don't wait in line until we feel like we're ready to deal with them. And most of the time, they rush in without warning. Amen? They don't come in one at a time. It's everything at one time. Have you noticed that? When things come your way, it just seems like everything falls in at one time. And how many of you have ever said this? What else is going to happen? What else is going to happen? And we say that, and what happens? Something else. Then all these challenges, like I say, they're coming at us. And when they come at us, we begin to get frustrated. Any of you ever been frustrated? I think we could all raise our hand tonight. This is a definition of the word frustration. A deep chronic sense or state of insecurity and dissatisfaction arising from unresolved problems or unfulfilled needs. And here are a few words that are associated with frustration. Now, I want to see if you can recognize any of them. These are associated with them. Aggravation. Anybody ever get aggravated? Dissatisfied. Unresolved. And disappointed. You know, frustration is a very heavy load to carry. And the longer we choose to remain bound to frustration, the heavier that burden gets. It turns into a vicious cycle. The weaker I feel, the more frustrated I get. The more frustrated I get, the weaker I feel. Aren't you thankful tonight? I want you to stop and think for just a moment that there are people that God puts in our life that can help us and can be there for us because they have walked through the fire. Isn't it wonderful to have someone come up to you when you're going through a difficult time, when you're so frustrated and down and out and discouraged and aggravated, and that person has been where you are? And they began to talk to you, and they began to tell you what God did for them. Can I tell you, God says He is no respecter of persons. And what He's done for one, He'll do for the other. Amen? Being close to them helps us to remember that we're not the only ones that are going through the fire. And sometimes, you know, we go through that fire and we think, man, this is so surprising and so unusual. We think what we're going through is just us. But then when we talk to someone else, we realize that there's other people that have walked in the same place that we're walking. And the thing about it is, if you stop and think for just a moment, if God brought somebody else out, He can bring you out. Amen. We need to remember that. We need to remember that. In the first portion of 1 Corinthians 10 and 13, it says, "No temptation has overtaken you except such is common to man. There are always others who have walked through the fire before we did." And we need to remember that they have a testimony, their examples, and their guidance will give us strength. Jason Crabb said that his dad taught him more about music and ministry than anyone. And he said everything that his dad did musically was done because he wanted to serve God. That was his purpose in his life, was to serve God. And you know what? That needs to be our purpose in life. And each one of us sitting here that knows the Lord as our Savior, and we're working for Him and trying to do our very best, you can rest assured that frustration is going to come your way sometime or the other. Amen? That's right. Some of his dad's best songs, I want you to listen to this, were written when he was in a place of weakness and frustration. And before recording one of his albums, Jason called his dad that day. He just called him to check on him and see how he was doing. And when he asked his dad, he said, "Hey, Dad, how are you doing?" Here's what he replied. He said, "I'm having a hard day, son. It's not a very good day." How many of you can identify? Yeah, we've all had those kind of days. But they talked a little while about what was going on, and then they went on to other things and ended the conversation. 3 days later, Jason's dad called him with a new song that he had written entitled, "Sometimes I Cry." And Jason ended up recording this song. And I want to play it tonight, and I want you to listen to it, because how many of you can identify with that? Sometimes I cry. Sometimes things come in life, and it's very hard to deal with. But I want you to listen to the words of this song, and I want you to think about it as you're listening to it, that Jason Crabb's dad, that day that he talked to him, was having this kind of day. And he realized it, and he let God use him to write a song so that it could reach out and help other people. So listen to the words. Christian tea,
How many of you can identify with that song? Sometimes you cry. Jason said that this song reminded him that weakness and frustration are a part of our life. It's going to come to each one of us, but we need to press through the difficult times that we have and realize that we are not alone. We need to have faith when we're going through the fire because the Lord Jesus Christ is right there with us. He said in His Word, I will never leave you or forsake you. And the hard thing is sometimes when we're going through that difficult time, we tend to forget that. And how many of you have ever cried out, Lord, where are you? I've done it. Lord, where are you? You know the answer? He's right there with you. We've got to be the ones to have faith through the fire. In 1 Peter 4, 12 and 13, the Word tells us, Beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you. But rejoice to the extent that you partake in Christ's suffering, that when His glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. We're being told in this verse not to think it strange when the fiery trials come our way. But we always do. I mean, I don't think it means to stand there and welcome them. But we have to realize that as children of God, the enemy's going to come after us, correct? But we need to put our faith and our trust in God. We have to rejoice because we're partaking in Christ's suffering. And when His glory is revealed, you will be glad with exceeding joy. We need to remember we are not alone. Think about that for a moment. We are not alone. It's then I am reminded I've never been forsaken and I've never had to stand the test alone. And that's one thing that the enemy uses against us very strongly. And we use at times. We're going through a very difficult time. And what we cry out is, God, where are you? God, where are you? Lord, why aren't you moving? Well, the thing about it is He's right there with you. And the enemy will tell you, God doesn't care. God's left. God doesn't care what you're going through with. He doesn't care. He does care. When you live a life of faith, listen to this. It's an adventure. It's also rewarding, exciting, and pleasing to God. But sometimes it has its challenges, correct? And there are times when it feels like that we are walking through that fire alone. And that's a terrible feeling. But we're not walking through that fire alone. And we need to understand that. Jason Crabb said that when he stepped out into what he called solo ministry, he said he honestly felt like he was about to walk off the edge of the earth. He said, when he said that, he said he felt like he was going to walk off the edge of the earth by himself without a net. He said that's exactly how he felt. And Jason said he didn't feel he was prepared for that big step that he had to take, but he knew that God had called him. You know, we know sometimes God calls us and tells us to do things, correct? And then we take that step out, and who shows up? The enemy. But let me tell you something. God is not going to leave you. He's not going to forsake you. He's always going to be there for you. He will put things, the enemy will put things in our way to make us feel like that God isn't there, but he is. What Jason didn't realize was that God had already made the way, because Jesus is the way maker. Isn't that wonderful that Jesus is the way maker? He's making a way for each one of you sitting here tonight, those watching by Facebook. He is the way maker, and he will make the way. And we, as children of God, need to learn to put our faith and our trust in him. I want to ask you a question, and I know what the answer is already going to be. Has God ever let you down? No. Things happen in our life we don't understand. There are things that we go through, but God is not going to let us down. He's always going to be there for us. Jason said when it looked like he was alone in that solo ministry, God provided two people, Philip and Tina, to come his way. And Philip left his full-time job to come and work in Jason's ministry. And he finally became Jason Crabb's, he became the manager of his ministry. And Jason said he could not imagine his life without the support and friendship of these two precious people. But God knew what he was going through. Tonight, you and I need to remember that no matter how big our situation is, we are not alone. We have something to shout about tonight, because God is on our side. That ought to make each one of us happy tonight to know that God is on our side. The enemy wants us to feel alone, discouraged, that God has forsaken us, but he's a liar. And that is not true. We need to realize that. Romans 8 and 31 says, if God is for us, then who can be against us? I am glad that God is on my side. And each one of us sitting here tonight, if I passed this microphone around, you would have a testimony of how God brought you out, how God was with you in a very dark and terrible time. We would all have a testimony to praise his wonderful name. But let me tell you, you may be going through it right now, but trust in the Lord, because he's going to bring you out. And you want to know why? We're going to listen to another song by Jason Crabb. And I hope y'all don't mind, but I just got excited. I started listening to him, and I got excited, and I thought I wanted you to hear him and get excited, because in just a minute, we're going to talk about, he's going to sing that song, The God of the Mountain. Oh, hallelujah. How many of you have heard that song? Aren't you glad that he's the God of the Mountain? And the wonderful thing about it is, he's a God in the valley. No matter what we're facing, no matter what we're going through with, we can put our faith and our trust in God, and you see what he's going to do. This song is very anointed. I'm just going to warn you up front, okay? I had a time in there listening to it, and I hope y'all have a time listening to it too, because it is a powerful, powerful song, so listen.
Never know.
What a powerful song. Aren't you so thankful that no matter what state you're in or what you're going through, that He is God no matter what? Whether you're down in that lowest valley or you're up on that highest mountain, He is still God. And that is something to be so thankful for tonight. I'm going to tell you a little story about a family whose house caught on fire. And each parent tried to grab a few belongings and their child's hand as they were trying to get out of the house as quick as possible. And the child was holding the father's hand, and she broke loose from her daddy's hand so she could run upstairs and get her teddy bear. She didn't want to leave her teddy bear in the fire. So when she tried to come back downstairs, she got trapped because the flames were starting to go up the stairs and she couldn't come down. So she ran upstairs, went to a window, opened it, and she started yelling. And she was yelling for her daddy to come help her. And he shouted back to her and he said, "Jump out of the window and I'll catch you." And the daughter couldn't see her dad because there was so much smoke, and she was afraid to jump, and she yelled back, "Daddy, I'm scared to jump. I can't see you." Her daddy replied back, "Don't worry, honey. You just jump. I'm right here, and I will catch you. Although you can't see me, I can see you." How many of you have ever felt like that with the Lord at times? And what He is saying is, you may not see me, you may not even be able to feel me, but I want you to know that I am here with you. That's what He's saying to us tonight. I am here with you. And we need to remember that, because we're all going to go through the fire at one time or another in our life. We're all going to go through times we do not understand, things that do not make sense to us, and we have to always go, "Why, Lord? Why?" How many of you have ever done that? Why? Why? Well, you know what? We may not even understand any of all that here on this side of eternity. And Brother Philip, when we get up there, it ain't going to matter, amen? It's not going to matter. But we need to remember, you're not alone. And even when you can't see Him, He is still working. That's what I want to leave you with tonight as we conclude this lesson, that you are not alone. He is always working all things for your good. Can you say amen to that? Amen. God bless each one of you for coming tonight. I appreciate it. And remember, next Wednesday we will be having our Easter drama. It'll be shown. So try to make plans to come out and see that. It's going to be wonderful. God bless you. Thank you.